Welcome back. Let's talk about lists. So lists are these containers in Python that you can store many types of data. So in this example, we have string, we have an integer, and we have a complex number. Okay, operations with lists. So you can append items to the end of the list with append. So this float 10 was added to the end of the list, my list, and you can insert elements, you specify the position, and lists, as everything in Python, starts with position 0. So here we are inserting at position 0 our string howdy to this list. So howdy comes here. It is prepended to the list. If the position would be 1, then it will insert howdy between Lihua and 100. Now, you can also obtain a similar result by adding one list to another. And so here you would be appending one list to the other and here prepending. However, when you do this, you are creating new lists. So here you are redefining the meaning of your variable list. So this is why we said earlier on that lists are like name tags. So you define your list earlier on, so it had some contents, and then when you add another list to it, but then you are assigning it again to the same variable name, my list now is a new list. It is not the list before with a new element. It's a complete new list, but that does is equivalent, or the outcome is as if you had inserted 10 to the end of the list. Okay, so we can also extend lists with the extend command. So in this case, we are adding one list with two elements to our initial list. This is the result. Indexing and slicing is really important and useful in Python. So we call the elements of our lists by their index that start at 0. So here, the element of index 0 from this list is 100. And we have special notation to say the position from the end. So -1 is the last position, -2 is the second position from the end. And if you want to delete one element, use del, and then the list and the element index. This notation is very interesting. So it says that you want to print, starting from element 1 of the list, up to but not including element 3. Element 0, 1, 2, 3. And so we are printing from element 1 up to, but not including, element 3. And this one here is then starting at element 1, Lihua, and the colon indicates is up to the end. So it's basically starting from here to the end. Okay. You can also use this notation with a double colon to specify the elements of your list, but with a step of 2. So you start with element 0, you step 2, step 2, step 2. Double colon and then the step value. Enumerate. This is one of my favorite constructs in Python and is useful when you have a container like a list and you want to retrieve both the items and their indexes. So if I use a for loop and I use enumerate my list, at each step enumerate will yield an index and the item that then you can print. This is very useful because you don't need to keep track of indexes inside the for loop. Enumerate will give them for you for free. list comprehensions are very useful because they can make code sometimes clearer and easier to read. So this is how you define a list comprehension. You use the square brackets, and your for loop is inside the list. And here we are looping variable x in range 10, so from 0 to 9. And each time we have a value of variable x, we square it. And this is the result. So we have a list. The first element, index 0, has the value of 0, because 0 square of 0 is 0. And then square of 1 is 1, but the square of 2 is 4, and so forth. So this is a very tight way of writing, very concise. Okay, now that we know more about lists, let's see how to plot them. Plotting lists is very simple. You just define your lists and you plot them with the plot command. You just have to be sure that the first two arguments, what I named earlier, x and y, they have to be of the same, they need to have the same number of elements. So in this case, I'm plotting x twice. So I get this straight line, and these dots represent the values of my list. Okay, now that we can plot lists, let's have a look at ensemble statistics. Ensemble statistics refers to having multiple realizations of the same experiment, but under the same conditions. So in this case, we have memory potential that is receiving some input, and each one of these traces is a realization of my memory potential. And these are realizations because the input is each time different. This is random synaptic input that is going into my neuron. And so the first statistic that we can obtain is the mean of Vt that changes in time. It started at the rest potential of 60 millivolts and went up to maybe minus 45. And then we can also plot and measure the standard deviation. So this is my plot of the mean, and this is mean plus standard deviation and mean minus standard deviation. So this is the kind of plots that we'll be doing in the tutorial. Okay, talking of which, let's go back to exercise 8, 9, and 10, where you will implement ensemble statistics and plot them.